Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise God.
Praise
the blood still works.
Amen.
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 The blood still works. Amen.
Amen.
Before I say anything, I know there's probably someone saying here, what blood? What is this blood that they sing about? So I just want to take a minute to talk about the blood that still works. Amen?
Amen?
You see, the scripture tells us that without the shedding of blood, there is no remission for sin, right?
Amen.
And so we're born into sin thanks to Adam and Eve. Amen?
Amen.
And we were damned, condemned. We couldn't save ourselves. Because we were not worthy. So God chose His Son, who was without sin, to come and pay that price for us, so that we could have life again, so that we could be connected again to our Father. So Jesus Christ came. He was the Lamb of God, who was to take away the sin of the whole world. He had to shed His blood, that we might be redeemed. And through His blood that was shed over 2,000 years ago, we have continued to be saved and redeemed forevermore. The blood of Jesus redeems us. Amen?
Amen.
It is this blood that we sing about this morning. We are grateful to God the Father for sending His Son Jesus Christ when we did not deserve it, to die on our behalf. Amen?
Amen.
That's the blood we sing about. Amen. I just want to say thank you to our able choir.
Amen.
Bring the energy, bring the presence of the Lord down. Prepare the place for worship. Thank you so much. I want to be grateful also and show gratitude to God, our Father, who gives us life. Gives us the health, the energy, and everything else that we need to be here this morning, to praise Him, to serve Him. There is nothing that we have that He hasn't given to us. So we just want to say, I want to say thank you, Lord.
Amen.
And also to the leadership of this congregation, from Chaplain Evander all the way to all our auxiliary leaders and our ministers, to just say thank you for this opportunity once more. And I want to thank you also for coming down this morning to serve God and praise His name in His house.
Amen.
Amen. Today, without further ado, I will be going to the book of Matthew, chapter 14, verse 15 to 21. And the title of my sermon this morning is Bring It to Me. And that's what Jesus said. Jesus Christ says, bring it to me. And I want to talk about what that means to bring it to Jesus. So the topic of my sermon is Bring It to Me. Now I was told that last week, when I wasn't here, because I was in the field, y'all went into the book of Matthew, and you did something about Jesus Christ feeding the 5,000. Well, I did not know about that. So we're going back there today for some reason. Amen? Now, by show of hands, how many of you can tell me if Jesus fed 5,000 or 4,000?
5,000?
Let me see your hands. 5,000? Jesus fed 5? How about 4,000? Bible scholars.
15.
He fed both. That was a count for men. But he fed 5,000 if you go to Matthew chapter 14. And when you go into 15, you see he fed 4,000 again. So when I was told that y'all did this before, I said to myself, Jesus did it twice. We can do it twice. Okay. I didn't plan this. It just happened. Amen. And you will see what happened when he did it the first time and he did it the second time. And you can go back and check. But we'll be reading it today. And so before I go into the Word of God, I'd like us to bow our heads for prayer. Amen. Heavenly Father, I just want to give you thanks for bringing us together again to gather together in one accord as we praise your holy name. Lord, I thank you because whenever we gather here, that you visit us and you bring your word and you give us something that we can go back with and be prosperous and be fruitful. But I bring myself before you this morning. I am not worthy. I have nothing to give, Lord. I ask, O Lord, that you will seize my mind and seize the words of my mouth. And I pray that, Lord, you will speak through me this morning. And I pray that, Lord, you hide me behind the cross, that I will diminish and that you will increase in the name of Jesus. I give you thanks and I give you praise once more. May your name be glorified. Take control, O Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, before I start, I would like to go back from where I read this morning in the book of Matthew chapter 14, verse 15 to 21. If you read that scripture, you would find out that Jesus Christ fed 5,000. Now, I'll give you a little bit of background before we go into that scripture. Jesus went to a place of mourning just before this event. Jesus had a cousin. His name was John the Baptist. John the Baptist and Jesus were close. They were blood relatives. However, John the Baptist was also the person who introduced Jesus Christ to the world. Jesus Christ once said in Scripture that amongst all the prophets that you know about, Elijah, Moses, Elisha, all the prophets, Jeremiah, and you can go on. Jesus Christ said John the Baptist is the greatest prophet that ever lived. That's how important John the Baptist was to Christendom, to Christianity, to Christ. But there was a ruler by the name of Herod Antipas, who was the son of King Herod the Great. King Herod the Great was the one who killed all the babies, all the little boys that were 2 years and younger, because he was trying to kill Jesus when Jesus was still a baby. He was a wicked ruler, and he had wicked sons that also became ruler when he passed. And it was one of his sons, Herod Antipas, that ended up killing John the Baptist. Why did he kill John the Baptist? John the Baptist spoke against him for the things that he was doing that was wrong, and he felt, I will lock you up because I have the power to do it. And he did. And so when he was celebrating his birthday, his daughter, or you could say stepdaughter, came and danced for him. And he says, you know what? You danced so well, I am pleased. And you have entertained me and my friends. So you can ask me anything, and I will give it to you. Well, this little girl's mom spoke into her ears and said, you need to ask for the head of John the Baptist. Of all the things that she could have asked for. And if I was in her position, I'd be thinking things like cars and money and houses and land. But no, she asked for the head of John the Baptist. Now, Herod didn't want to do it because he was scared of the people and so on. But because he gave his word in the presence of his friends, he wanted to preserve his pride. And so he went ahead and did it. And the news came to Jesus. John is gone. Jesus was sad, like I would be, like anyone here would be. And he decided to withdraw and go to a desolate place, say mourning, in grief. While he was there, a quiet place where he wanted to be alone and just mourn the death of this important figure to him, people heard that Jesus was over there and they started to troop to go figure out, to go find out one or two things about Christ. They wanted to go see, is that you? What do you have for us? And they were trooping. Amongst the crowd were believers and non-believers. Some people believed in him because of what he was doing, and some people just went to see. Now, if that was me, I'm not ready for y'all. I'm worrying. I'm in grief. Leave me alone. But the Bible says Jesus Christ saw the crowd, and he had compassion on them. And he had compassion on them. And he decided to minister to them. Okay? It was through ministering to them for a period of time that the people became hungry. They became hungry. And Jesus Christ said to the disciples, "These people are hungry." The disciples said, "Well, yes, they are. So why don't you send them away? Because this place where we are is a desolate place. There is nothing here. There's no food. There is no shelter. There's nothing. So why don't you send them away?" Jesus Christ said to the disciples, "Why don't you feed them?" He said to the disciples, "Why don't you feed them?" The disciples says, "We don't have anything. All we have, 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. And the Lord says, "Bring it to me." If you go on to the next chapter, you will see when Jesus Christ was done with this group of people, this was in Israel. He took a trip out of Israel, and he went to a pagan land. And while he was there, guess what happened again? People gathered, and he taught them for 3 days, and they had nothing to eat. And the disciples came to Jesus again and said, "It's been 3 days, these guys haven't eaten. Why don't we send them away to go get food? Because this place where we are is a desolate place, and there is nothing." Jesus Christ says to them again, "Why don't you get them something to eat?" They says, "Well, we don't have anything." Jesus says, "What do you have?" This time it was 7 loaves. The Bible never gave us a number for the fish, but there was fish. I think fish and bread was kind of a staple diet at that time because they're always having bread and fish. And so Jesus said, "Bring it to me again." And he blessed it, and he gave it to them. The first time there was 12 baskets left over. The second time there was 7 baskets left over. What am I trying to say this morning? As I open up and I show you those 2 passages of scripture, what am I trying to say this morning? First of all, I would like you to know that in the crowd that Jesus Christ fed were all kinds of people. There was believers and there was non-believers. But I also want you to know that everybody ate. Amen? That gives me some form of encouragement. Why does it do that for me? First and foremost, I want you to know that that crowd got up from their homes and came over to see Jesus. That's all they did to begin with, number one. And that crowd is no different than the crowd we have in here this morning. We have a crowd here, and you all came out to come and meet with the Lord. In every crowd, there is going to be some believers and some non-believers. But I also want you to know that Jesus Christ will take care of the entire crowd. There is a journey that we take as believers. It begins with a step. Get up. Let me go find him. And in this crowd, you had those people. You had those people who just got up. I said, "Let's go check out what he is about. Who is he? What does he do? Where does he get the words that he speaks?" But they were present. And I want you to know that they were present. There is something tangible about being in the presence of God. You know, we say God is everywhere. He's omnipresent. He's everywhere. But there is something to be said when you get up from the presence of God in your home and come to the presence of God in his house. Yes. The people who partook, who ate of that bread, were there. That bread didn't go home. It was right there. So I want to encourage you, find out where it is happening and go. If the people of God are gathering together in His house, you want to be there. Because there is provision in that space. Because when the Lord is done talking to you, He might just come to you in person and give you something special because you came. He said the people were hungry. If you live life long enough, you will come to a place of hunger. If you live life long enough, you will come to a place of need. If you live life long enough, you will come to a place of want. My question to you is, where would you be when that need arises? Would you be in the presence of the Lord, or would I be running away and doing something somewhere else? Looking for bread, where I got no business looking for bread. Remember what they said, the place was desolate. What does it mean to be in a desolate place? Abandoned. These are some words that are connected with desolate. Deserted, joyless, sorrowful, neglected, devoid of warmth or comfort. That's a desolate place. I am not surprised that the disciples felt we can't get food from here. There's nothing here. And how many people in here this morning feel like they're in a place that looks or feels like this place where you're asking the Lord, like, what is in here for me right now? Nothing is working. I'm giving it my best shot. And I'm trying hard. Nothing is working. The desolate place is a place where nothing works. It's a place of hopelessness. It's a place where things fail. It's a place where nothing happens. Place of failed job situations, a lost cause, failed relationships, a place where trying is not even necessary anymore. There's no need to try. That's what a desolate place feels like. That's what it looks like. I wonder if someone here is facing a desolate place. Scripture says also that the disciples also said that the time is far spent. The time is far gone. That speaks to a situation where time is gone, and so you can't get that time back. How many people feel that way? I wasted the best years of my life. I wasted my time doing this or doing that, and I can't get that time back. That's the situation that we're facing at that time. Time is up, and the day is over. And now the disciples told Jesus, go ahead and send them away. Let them go fend for themselves. How many of you know that if they had sent them away, they would have left starving because the place was desolate? They said it. There was nothing. So sending them away is just to say, get rid of the problem and let it be somebody else's problem. So that's not my problem. I want you to know that there is one, it's called the evil one, that continues to petition the Lord to send us away. He continues to remind the Lord he's not worthy. He continues to sin. They continue to do wrong. They're no good. Send them away. And I bless God and I thank Him. Because He says, no, I will not send him away. I will not send her away. I'll feed them. Are we worthy? No, we're not. But Jesus decides, why don't we do something about it? Is someone here this morning feeling like they've been sent away? I tell you, Jesus Christ says, no. No. I'm not going to send you away. You might feel like you're alone. You might feel lonely. You might feel like you're in a desert place. But the Lord says, I'm not sending you away. I will feed you. And you read the book of Job. It tells you exactly how the enemy works. continually petitions the Lord to send them away. Christians all over the place, people in scriptures will tell you how at one point or the other they felt like it was all lost. In a desert place, nothing is happening. A place of fear. But the Lord says, I am not going to send them away. I will feed them. And so when the Lord decided that he was going to feed them, he asked them, what do you have? And the Lord is asking someone here this morning, what do you have? It is very clear that what I have is not enough. That's the reason why I'm in need. And what they had was not enough. They didn't have enough. It was a hopeless situation. But the Lord is telling someone here this morning, bring it to me. What do you have? What's in your hand? Bring it to me. You might say this morning, I'm running out of patience. Maybe it's time to start praying, the Lord, help my patience. You might be saying this morning, I'm running out of love. I'm running out of whatever it is that you are hanging on to. And the Lord is saying, turn it over. Surrender the situation. Bring it to me. He is the only one that has the ability to take 5 loaves of bread, feed 5,000, and have some left over. Amen. Amen? So the Lord is saying, bring it to me. Let me have that situation. He says, what do you have? What are your works? So the Bible says faith without works is dead, right? So no works. Faith is dead. You got to bring something. Sometimes I tell the Lord, I bring myself. It's all I got. I bring myself. What's in your hands? What are you willing to surrender? What are you willing to sacrifice? Are you willing to sacrifice that pride? What are you willing to give up? Are you willing to give some patience for the cause? Will you give some perseverance? He can take that and expand it. One thing is for sure, we always have something. It may not be enough, but there's always something that we have to offer. The Lord is willing to take that something and make it more than enough. Might there be someone here this morning who feels that they have given their best shot? I've done my best, and I'm about to quit. I've been patient long enough. I have loved hard enough. I have nothing to give. The Lord is saying this morning, as he said to the disciples, bring it to me. When you have tried everything, perhaps it is time to surrender all. Maybe someone here needs to say a prayer. Say, Lord, help my faith. Lord, help my patience. Because I have run out. Jesus, go with me because I cannot go alone. Now, in the hands of Jesus Christ, he sees the struggles. He knows the response. He hears your heart. See, you can go to the Lord and you can tell him exactly how it is in your heart. You know why? Because he already knows. Some people say, you know, I don't want to question God. I don't want to say, God, why? He already did. He sees your heart. You know the difference between asking God why and asking God why? There is a difference. The one why, no relationship. It sounds like a challenge. Who are you? The other why, there is a relationship. There's nothing wrong with that. If you are close with someone and you walk to them and you say why, they feel like they owe you an explanation. You know why? Because it's a relationship. I want to preserve this relationship. I will tell you why. Maybe you can understand with me. Now, you don't know this guy from nowhere. You go say why, he'd be like, what's why? What gives you the right to ask me that? The Lord is okay with us. Having a relationship with him and telling me exactly how we feel. And if the question is why, you might as well go ahead and say it. Because if it runs through your heart, he already heard it. Amen? It takes faith. It takes faith to surrender completely to God. It also takes a relationship to surrender completely to God. It is so hard. It is almost impossible to give all to a stranger. It is so hard, I repeat, to surrender to a stranger, to someone you have no relationship with. The key to surrendering to the Lord is having a relationship with the Lord. The key to giving it all to the Lord is knowing the Lord. How you give all to someone you have no clue who they are? Having that relationship. Let me tell you what a relationship feels like. Job said these words, "Even though he slay me, yet I will trust him." Think about those words for a moment. I trust him so that even though he slay me, yet will I trust him. But how about the three Hebrew boys? The king says, when you hear this music stop, everybody bow down to the golden image. And so the music stopped. And everybody went down. Those three boys standing up there. The king was like, who are those boys? Three Hebrew boys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And the king said, bring them forward. He was about to give them a second chance. They say, oh king, you don't need to give us a second chance. We heard you the first time. And they were so bold, they told him, we are not careful to answer you in this matter. Then now here comes it. Here comes the shout. Here comes the shout. If our God is not going to deliver us, so be it. They said, we believe our God can save us. However, because we have a relationship with this God, we go for it. We'll stand with him. And if he doesn't deliver us, so be it. See, when you turn your situation and your circumstances into the hands of God, you have to trust him however he takes it. It might get worse before it gets better. If you notice, God did not save those boys from the fire. He saved them in the fire. They had no clue what was going to happen. They had no clue. They were ready to die for a God that they loved and had a relationship with. And the Lord decided, I'm not going to save them from the fire. They went all the way in. They gave it all. That is the total surrender. It is impossible to do that with a God that you do not know. It's impossible to do that with a Jesus that I have no relationship with. And he saved them while they were in. The Bible says a king who had no clue who God was, who cared nothing for the God Jehovah of Israel, looked in the fire and recognized the Son of God. How does this happen? A man who had no clue who God was. But when Jesus shows up, I'm telling you, the Bible says, every knee will bow. And every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. Because everyone will recognize him when he shows up. If you doubt me, go read the book and see what Nebuchadnezzar went through. He had no clue who this guy was. He had no clue who Jesus was. He didn't care for God. But when he saw Jesus appear in that fire, he recognized him. So I want to tell you this morning, turn it into God's hands and surrender. However, you have to give it all and say, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. You have to be ready sometimes for things to get worse before they get better. And I am praying to God to give you the faith to say, and even if they don't get better, So be it. The God we serve is the God of this life and the next. This is the hope we have. Think about it for a moment. How many years do we have here? It will go this way. Disclosure, I'm already 40. So I believe I'm halfway there. I know I'm young, but I believe I'm already halfway there. At 40. I'm wondering where did all those years go? And as I look, I see those who are way, way ahead of me. Time on earth is short. But we have a God who is an eternal God. Who doesn't just secure the 80 years here on earth, or the 90 or the 100 or whatever years that anyone here is striving to live, but he can secure you for the rest of our lives forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. And it goes on and on and on. And we worry about the little percentage that we have to spend here. And we fight so hard, and we fight each other, and we try to climb that ladder of progress, and try to step on other people for a short percentage of years that we have here. And we're not even guaranteed tomorrow. This is why we have to love. This is why we have to hold hands. This is why we have to support each other. Because, hey, the time here is really short. We just talked about a memorial for one of our brothers, right? He's already with Jesus. 2 months ago, he was here. We have to pay attention to these things. The time here is short. So use your time wisely. Use your time wisely to the glory of God. It comes and it goes. Very often, we experience God's goodness in our lives, and we make it to the next level and tend to forget how he brought us through. So I go back now, and like I told you from the beginning, there was him feeding the 5,000, and there was him feeding the 4,000. If you go back to Matthew, read all the way from chapter 15 to 16, you see it in there. But what baffles me is how we forget who brought us to where we are right now. And we lose faith like we brought ourselves over here. These disciples of Jesus Christ just saw him feed 5,000 people with 5 loaves of bread. And if not too long, they're asking the same question. How are we going to feed these people? If you read it, sometimes you'd be like, is it like, did they just repeat the same thing? Like, is my battle wrong or what's going on? That's what you would think. They fell for the same trick, if you want to call it that, twice. Now they fell for it even 3 times. Because if you keep reading the scripture, Jesus was trying to tell them something at the very end, and he mentioned bread, and they were like, well, we don't have any bread. And Jesus finally said to them, don't you guys get it? You still thinking about food? Didn't you just see me feed 5,000 and then see me feed? You guys don't get it still? And before we hit on them so hard, we do the same thing. Who brought you here? How did you make it this far? Why are you feeling so depressed and desolate, knowing fully well I didn't bring myself here? How many times did Jesus challenge his disciples? Look at the birds. Who clothed them? And he said, you are more important than them, but your father made sure that they're clothed and they're fed. Why don't you think he will take care of you? He said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, right? And every other thing will be added unto you. They didn't get it. But we don't get it too. Because we stay worried. And we forget to bring it to the Lord. We have someone in our corner who is very quiet, very reserved. And that's my picture of Jesus Christ. Because in the book, he's sleeping and the storm is just shaking everything. He's at the corner. Or he goes to a desolate place to pray and the people are coming looking for him, wanting him to do something. We have that kind of person. We have that kind of God in our corner. We have no reason to be scared. But we will be. asking the same question over and over. You brought me from year one to year two. Well, how am I going to make it to year four? Then you get me to year four. Well, how am I going to make it to year five? And then you bring me to year five. How am I going to make it to year seven? And then you get to year seven. How am I? And it keeps going. We do it all the time. Let's not be hard on the disciples. Jesus is saying, just bring it to me. Just bring it to me. Sometimes I know God has saved me from my own self. I don't know about you. See, my testimony is not as interesting as so many people's testimonies. God has saved some people from some really deep things. But I don't only thank God for what he saved me from, but I thank him for what he saved me from getting into. If you never did drugs and you never did all those different things that get people trapped, you ought to thank God too for saving you from that. Amen. It is awesome for God to deliver an addict, but it's also awesome for God to save you from becoming one. There is saving in both situations. So God saved me from myself many times. I've been involved in car accidents and motorcycle accidents in the past, and he saved me. My mom was hit by an 18-wheeler kind of vehicle, and her car was crushed and squeezed. And my brothers thought this was it. She was not going to make it. She's alive today. I'm sure if we gave everyone here an opportunity to testify, you would be able to go back and see how God has brought you through from point A to where you are today. But that same God is alive today. And he can take control of whatever situation we may be going through. Amen? Now, finally, as I conclude, the tendency we have is to run away because we don't feel worthy. If you look at scripture, you find that whenever people did something wrong or when they felt weak, they went to hide. They ran away. Adam ate from the fruit. He wasn't supposed to. Found out he was naked. What did he do? Go hide. Jonah didn't want to do what God asked him to do, so he decided to take a boat and run for it. Run away. And we do that sometimes. When we are weakest, we stop praying. When things are not going right, and we're asking the question, God, if you neglected me, we stop praying. We stop coming to church. We stop hanging around people of God. Because we feel he has abandoned us. But I want to tell you something, folk. That is the time to actually draw close. Yes. Think about that for a moment. When I was younger, whenever I was sick, that's when my parents were closest to me. What do you want to eat? To give you anything that day, you can have as much sugar as you want. You have whatever you want. Sometimes I used to wish I was sick so I could ask for anything. How does anyone else eat that? But I did that sometimes. When we are weakest, when we have disobeyed, when we have fallen short, when we know that we are wrong, when we know that we've done something we should not be doing, that is the time to run towards the Father. That is the time to get closer. He says, my strength is made perfect in your weakness. The tendency for us to take off, go to a far country where nobody knows us. And sometimes as believers, we do not help that situation. When we learn that our brother or sister has done something they shouldn't do, we talk about them and we push them away. We try not to hang with them. Right? We say stuff about them. But I'm telling you, that is the time to come together. That's the time that they are weak. Some people say the weakest chain or the weakest link is as strong as we're going to get. That's the time to bring strength to that weak link. That's the time to come to God. So as I close, I want you to understand something. The crowd that came to Jesus was a mixture of everybody. He took care of all of them. They had a choice. The disciples had a choice. Send them away or do something about it. Jesus said, we will do something about it. We will not send them away. So sending them away would have been the easy way to go. How many times do we always take the path of least resistance? Do the easy thing. The easy thing is not to pray in the crowd. The easy thing is not to identify myself as a Christian. The easy thing is to maintain an approach that is loved and accepted by everybody. The hard thing is to say I'm a Christian. The hard thing to do is to say, I am not just a Christian, it's who I am, it's how I operate. You cannot separate me from my Jesus. We go together. That's hard to say in this society. It's hard to leave that life where we are. But you see, God is going to raise people that will stand for him, and he will put them in positions of authority. And he expects you to shine that light for the world to see. If God has raised you up, he has raised you for a purpose. And if you do not know that, you need to be asking the Lord, why did you put me here? Because he didn't just put you there by mistake. You are there for a reason. You are there so you can bring righteous judgment to those that are under you. He has made you a leader in your community so you can shine forth the light of Christ. In love, in righteousness, in mercy, in justice, in grace. I think people ought to see us and understand that the reason why we do what we do is because we have a God that we serve. And if I'm not passing that information, something is off. So the crowds came, and Jesus decided to do something about it. And he asked them, what did you have? What do you have? And they brought what they had, which was not enough. And that's okay. Jesus is saying, bring me what you have. It is not enough, but I'll do something with it. But like I said, once again, it is hard to surrender, to give your all to a God that you do not know. So if you are in here this morning, and you are wondering, who is this Jesus? If you are part of the crowd that came to see something, to experience something, but you're just part of the crowd, you would have an opportunity this morning to meet with Christ intimately. To meet with Christ on a personal level that helps you on the day of trouble, on the day of distress, to be able to say, here is my all. Even though you slay me, yet will I trust you. When I was a child, in closing, I lived in West Africa, and over there, having malaria is like having a migraine. I would at least suffer malaria once a year, or twice. And whenever I had that situation, there was a drug called chloroquine that took care of it. Chloroquine was painful. You could only get it with shots. And that shot was very painful. And I always thought my parents hated me, but they didn't. It was because they loved me that they took me to the doctor to get the shot. I thought the shot would kill me before the illness. That's what I used to think. But they were like, oh no, you'll feel pain, but you'll be okay eventually. Sometimes when we bring it to the Lord, he gives you a shot. And that shot might be painful, but you gotta be going there, even though you slay me, yet will I trust you. Even though you slay me, yet will I trust you. Because that shot will make you better eventually. Yes. So as we rise up and we close in prayer, I want to say something in this congregation. If you want to meet with Christ, if you need prayer at any point in time, you could stop a minister or a chaplain and say, please pray with me, and we'll do it. I do not want you to wait for the end of the service all the time to be able to do that. You can do that at any, you can do that at the beginning of the service. You can do that at the end of the service. You can do that while we're in the fire. You can do that, see, when you see me walking down the street, hey, can you pray with me? And I'll be happy to do that. We are open 24/7 to God's business, amen?
Amen.
And so if you feel, all hands bowed and eyes closed as we go to the Lord in prayer. If you would like someone to pray with you and for you, step forward and want out of our ministers, we meet